Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the Texas USA 2013 series. The topic is Basic Principles of Progression, presented by Jesus on the 9th of November 2013 in Austin, Texas, USA. This is Session 1, Part 1.
Okay. And I'm the green man today. What I'd like to do first, actually, is read you a bit of an excerpt of The Life Elysian. How many of you have actually read this book? Yeah, a few? Good. I'd recommend reading it over and over. I think I've read them 20 times or so far, these books. But Corny pointed out to me something the other day that's a good thing for you to bear in mind with these sessions. Is it ringing a bit? Just before we get started, though, I'd like to say we talked about you yesterday with our spirit friends. Yeah, it was a terrible conversation. No, it's not that bad. It's interesting because the general emotions that you guys have are generally the kind of emotions that we find the average group has anywhere we go in the world, pretty much. So there are groups of people that fall into different categories of why you're here and those kind of things, which we'll discuss with you today. Now, over the next week or so, we'll probably have a session like this every second day if you want to attend. It'll be from 2 o'clock to around 5:30, quarter to 6, something like that, depending on how long you want it to be, of course. And we will be discussing things pertaining to your own lives, if that's up. But it's up to you how much you'd like to share. Bear in mind, if you do start sharing or asking questions, you are getting recorded and it will be placed on YouTube. So if you don't want that to occur, then just don't share. Just sit without participation in the audience if that's what you want to do. Our suggestion is you participate, take the opportunity to participate. Are there any questions you have about the week coming from our perspective before we begin? Everyone's pretty much okay. It's all been drummed into you beforehand anyway by someone else. Okay, well, let's start by reading what I'd like to read to you from the Life Elysian list. This is the beginning of chapter 3, and it's the second paragraph of chapter 3 of the Life Elysian, if you'd like to read it at any point in time yourself. But I felt it pertained pretty well to our sessions this coming week. It says, "The surgeon who drives his scalpel deep is not necessarily the enemy of our well-being, but rather our true, if painful, friend. It is the foreign and dangerous growth he removes that necessitates the operation he performs. So, in our spiritual unfoldment, the foes to truth and health must needs be cut away before we shall be allowed to tread the inner courts of the Father's house. I'm not altogether unprepared for the angry exclamations and hard accusations that are ejaculated during the operation, but I also know that in the coming days you will discover that, in the language of a well-known hymn, the bittersweet, the medicine is food. Bitter is sweet, the medicine is food. And I can wait until that time to hear your calm and grateful opinion." And I thought that quietly reflected my own feelings about these coming sessions. I realise that many of you may feel a little angry with what I raise with you and feel a little confronted by what I raise with you, which is pretty normal for pretty much everybody who we speak with. So what you do is going to, what you choose to do is going to have a big effect on the outcome of these particular sessions. So the average person firstly needs to bear in mind one thing, and that is, I'm not trying to make your life hard. All I'm trying to do is show you how to get closer to God. That's all. I'm not trying to pull you apart, and I'm not trying to destroy anything other than any false image that you have of yourself. In other words, I'm trying to get rid of the dangerous growths, if you could think of it like cancers, that are within our soul that prevent our relationship with God. I'm not trying to make your life any more difficult or any of those kind of things. Hopefully, during these sessions, we can have a great discussion that's really open and honest and truthful about lots of different matters, whatever matters you decide you want to have a discussion about, in fact. But I don't feel my own motivation for being here is to make your life difficult. There have been some people, obviously, that helped us get here financially, and we'd like to thank those people as we have the opportunity now to do so. So we'd like to thank those of you who allowed us to come, myself and Mary. We're grateful for the opportunity to be here, but it is also, please bear in mind, that we are giving you the gift of our time, and we have no expectations of how you use that. So if you want to get angry, you can get angry, and if you want to get upset, you can be upset. If you want to leave, you can leave. If you want to stay, you can stay. If you want to be happy about the result, then be happy. But if you want to be sad, then be sad. Like, we don't have any expectations that you change the way you do things. What we would like to point out to you, though, that if we feel that you are projecting a lot of anger at ourselves, myself and Mary, or Corny, if he's giving some advice to you, then we're just basically, if we're in a group like this, we'll ask you to leave. If you refuse to, we will. Quite simple. And that means that the group will be left having to, with its own devices as to what it's going to do for the rest of the time. Myself and Mary and Corny have no desire to put up with anger or rage from people, but we do know that you will sometimes feel angry about what we said. Does that make sense? So if you can learn to own your emotions about what is said to you, that'd be great. Bear in mind that we won't be saying anything to you that you didn't first invite. Does that make sense? So if you don't put up your hand in these sessions and you don't make any comments and you don't ask any questions, then there's a high likelihood you won't invite anything, any comment from us. Now, I don't know if I'd recommend that kind of that kind of behavior. It seems to be a bit pointless exercise being here if that was what you're going to do. But that's what I suggest for you to do if you have any challenge about receiving anything that we might say. So if you can just bear in mind that I'm like a doctor trying to help you recover from some serious damage that's happened in your past. And I have no desire to make your life difficult. That's the first thing that I'd like to remind you. The second thing I'd like to remind you is that how you respond will depend upon your choice. And you are allowed to make any choice you wish. And that choices range from, like I said, just running out and never coming back, right the way through to being open and humble about what you might receive. We do not expect you to believe everything we say, but we do expect that you listen to what is said if you've asked us a question and want to hear an answer from us. And we feel that if we give you an answer and we feel you don't want to receive it, then we won't give you any more answers. Does that make sense? And that is us honouring your will as to what you will receive. So that's what we're trying to do. Now, can I ask you guys, why are you here? Has anyone got some opinions they'd like to venture about why they're here? Let's start over here. So then, if you wait for the mic, that's it.
I'm Catherine, and I'm here because I really have come to love truth.
Yeah.
And really want it and desire truth. And so I'm really thankful that you're willing to share truth, God's truth, with us.
That's our pleasure, Catherine. That's a good motivation for being here, yes. Lawrence, if we go.
Lawrence, I would like to see, know, and feel the truth of my soul condition.
Yep.
Release the errors of my soul and be at one with God.
Okay, so you'd like to have an idea of how to be more self-reflective? Is that the underlying feeling you have?
I know that there are...
If you hold the mic a bit.
I know that there are errors of my soul that I'm just not feeling right now.
Yeah, you're not conscious of.
I might have a mental intellectual awareness of them.
Yeah.
But I haven't felt them yet.
Yep. Yep.
And I know that's probably going to be painful. And I'm looking forward to the surgeon.
Well, if you think about it, if you had cancer and you were on your deathbed, you'd probably look forward to the surgery, wouldn't you?
Right.
Yeah. No worries, Nina, if we come forward.
I've just been, feel I've benefited from time that you've offered me in the past.
Yeah.
And feel really grateful for that, and like often thank both you and Mary for everything that you've done and offered, and I'm just really keen to keep walking this way.
Yep.
And this seemed like an amazing opportunity.
Yeah, it's not something that happens very frequently.
Yeah, and I think living close to you, I really, you know, personally aware of that. So it was like, wow, I'm in.
Yeah, because I don't think we've done this ever, actually.
No.
So myself and Mary have not done what we're doing this week ever. If we go back to Angela and then across to Sai.
Hi, my name's Angela, and I'm here because I, too, very much love truth and desire truth and feel that that by coming here, it was an opportunity to maybe have more truth exposed to me that I'm blocking on my own or not seeing on my own.
Yep. G'day. Sai?
I'm Sai, and I came because I wanted to be confronted, and I feel that I love truth and want to learn to honor truth more in my life.
Yep.
And that I still have a lot of problems emotionally processing, getting to my emotions, because I've just played Zen for so long that you know, I think I'm okay,
yep.
And yet inside of me, I know I'm not okay.
Yeah.
And I wanted to come and have that confronted, and I wanted to hear you say to me that I'm not done yet, even though it was my greatest fear, and that there was a long way to go, and there were many issues that were going to be painful, and I wanted to be able to welcome that in person,
yeah.
as opposed to through the medium. And I really appreciate that you three are here with us today.
Yeah,
and
thanks,
it's just an honor to be with you. Thank you.
Yeah, we feel it's an honor to be with you guys too. So that's already started for you last night. Yeah. Good. If we come.
My name is Vesna, and I'm a truth seeker.
Uh-huh.
And
just hold it up a little bit straighter, that's it.
Oh, good. I'm a truth seeker.
Yeah.
And I'm just so happy to meet you.
Yeah.
To meet Cornelius. And meet Mary.
Yeah.
I'm just thrilled. I came here because I wanted to meet you.
Yeah. Yep. Well, now you've met us. Are you going home? No, it's just okay. Anybody else like to make the guys in the middle there? If we start, yep.
Hi, I'm Kevin.
Kevin.
And I'm here like most of us, which we are truth seekers, and this is the teaching of the divine truth. So it's clearly an opportunity,
yep.
to dive deeper and potentially more clearly into the truth. And I was told that if I came here that I might have memories of the first century, so...
Okay. I can assure you, you might. not unless they're given to you.
Okay.
By some spirits, yeah. Okay. And we go across to David.
Hi, I'm David. I came here because I have a very strong desire for truth. And I need a lot of help,
yep.
So I knew y'all could help. I wanted to know how to actually build my personal relationship with God,
mm-hmm.
and to begin to see myself as God sees me,
yep.
and work with that,
yep.
and find out what it is, how does God see me, and what I need to actually do.
G'day. Would you like to know what your spirit friend said about why you're here? All right, well, I'll get some of the notes we took yesterday. Have you noticed that whenever we make personal comments about our own motivations, usually they're always in the positive? Very rarely are they in the negative. Have you noticed that? And what does that tell us, really? It probably tells us that we're not very good at seeing all of our motivations for things. We're just basically used to seeing only what we believe are our good motivations for things. All right? So don't be surprised that some of our spirit friend comments are not as positive as what you have said. Okay? So here's the first reason why some people are here. Because they're basically needy. And they need to have reassurance. Now, how many of you would put yourself in that category of needing reassurance and feeling needy? Yep, okay. People who want someone to do all the work for them, they want hand-holding through decisions and feelings. They still have many New Age practices. How does that sound? How many would agree with that? Yeah, see, a lot of you are not being honest with yourself. Sorry about that. Interesting. Three, people who want personal time with Jesus and Mary or Cornelius, they believe they are special case scenarios. They believe their situation is different to the average person and the general advice in previous seminars does not really apply to them. How many of you, you would feel that? People who are here because they want to be told they are doing well or believe they are doing well and want some feedback telling them such. How do you put it there? Okay. People who desire others and themselves to shut down emotionally. How many of you are still here in that place? Yeah. People under heavy spirit influence, they are under dark influence to undermine the proceedings. This is very common in most of our events, actually. We have large groups of people generally who have a lot of that kind of influence. People who want to say, I was there when, and they want to brag or feel superior to other people who weren't here when. How's that sound to that? And then people with a sincere desire to grow, they want to use their time well. How's that? Now, there was 7 out of 8 of those comments were possibly not as positive as what you were hoping, but pretty accurate, I think. So what we would like to do over the coming few days is really deconstruct a lot of that stuff with you, if we can. We feel quite strongly, I believe they are the reasons why many of you have come. And I can feel those in you. And already you can see in the last 2 days already, many of you have hooked into your addictions quite strongly with each other. Many of you are not spending time alone that you need to spend if you're ever going to be contemplative and ever going to have a relationship with God. And in some ways, you then start sharing with each other emotionally your own progression, when the reality is nobody else can actually feel your emotions for you ever. Nobody can share your emotions with you. Nobody can feel your emotions for you. Nobody can grow for you. Nobody can really help you grow unless you have a desire personally to change. So my suggestion is to have a reflection about what our spirit friend said, because those comments I feel are fairly accurate in terms of why the average person is here. All right. Okay, well, what would you like to do? Deconstruct? Okay. What I would like to do is just raise one more issue with you, and that is to do with your choices. You can, during this week or so, and many of you have paid quite a lot of money to be here, I understand. You know, you've flown or driven here, and obviously you're paying, because it's a venue that other people own, you know, we're paying a fee to those people to have the event run here. And we are a guest, just like you are a guest of the people who invited us. And we'd probably just like to take the opportunity to thank particularly Robin, who's done a lot of work, and Carolyn, who's done a lot of work behind the scenes. And so Carolyn and Michael as well, so Michael Bailey, so yeah. And there's been a lot of touring and froing as well, back and forth between us and those people. But we'd really like to thank you guys for your hard work, and hopefully now that it's all together, you can relax a bit more and and just allow yourself to feel what's going on for you guys personally, rather than looking after all of us all the time. If it wasn't for their desire, actually, to do this, it wouldn't have happened. As I've pointed out, myself and Mary haven't normally done these particular things. So, and we're here basically as from their invitation. And so we decided that we're going to make our time available every second day for 3 to 4 hours to interact with you guys. And we would like you guys to relax and just share what you would like to know about, you know, what you'd like to ask questions about, and just relax with that. Now, if you decide you want to ask questions about a certain thing, but we feel that the majority of the group are not going to benefit from discussing that particular thing, we won't probably have those discussions. We feel we'd like to have discussions with you about what we feel would benefit most of you collectively together, because we don't feel that having individual discussions in a collective group actually helps everybody in the group to grow. That being said, many of your personal questions that you have are definitely appropriate for the majority of people in the group. So don't be afraid to ask personal questions and have a discussion about them. Okay, as the group gets smaller, it will do during the week, I understand. This is the biggest the group will be, I understand, isn't it? And then some of you are only staying 6 or 5 days or 3 days or so forth. So as the group gets smaller, we may change the layout here so that we're more, you know, can be closer with each other and I can interact with you more closely. But at the moment, this is probably the best way to arrange our auditorium, if we can call it that, while we're having these interactions with a larger group. Okay, well, I am at your disposal for 4, 8, 12, 16, possibly 20 hours. All right. If we can start with Angela. Thanks.
Thank you. Earlier this week, well, I guess we've been here a couple of days, but I guess it was maybe yesterday, you had mentioned in a conversation that we were having that I was carrying my stepfather's shame. And so my question is, with regards to that, because I haven't really, I guess maybe been able to access too much shame, or I guess I don't know what it looks like. Or mm-hmm. So I was hoping that you could address that. And
yes, certainly. Yeah. I feel shame is a big issue that a lot of people need to face, and I'd love to address the issue of shame. Here we're talking about shame that comes from sexual abuse. So put it into context of sexual abuse in your childhood, and there's shame related to sexual abuse in the childhood. But obviously shame comes from all sorts of things that have happened in our childhood where we were shamed by other people during our childhood. So let's describe what's happening a bit. And usually there's a person, an adult, so who, when we were a child, did something to us. And in the case of sexual abuse, they sexually abused us, obviously. So sexual, let's use the situation of sexual abuse, but it could be violent abuse. It could be to do with personal violence from the adult to the child, and it could be to do with even humiliating the child verbally and emotionally all the time. So all forms of abuse we're talking about here, whether it's physical, emotional, or sexual. So let's look at the sexual abuse. Now, usually when this adult abuses the child in any way, whether it's violent, physical, emotional, or sexual, the adult tells itself that it has nothing to be ashamed of. In other words, what the adult generally does is it blames the child for the adult's actions towards the child. So, for example, when the child is hit, violently abused, the adult says it's your fault that I'm doing this because it's something you did. Does that make sense? So the adult blames the child. When the adult blames the child, this has the effect of creating openings inside of the child where the child thinks that it has something to be ashamed of. In other words, it believes, the child believes, that it is the problem. It has the shame. It is the person who has the problem. Does that make sense? Because the adult has taught the child to believe such things. All right? So whose shame is this really? Can you see it's not really the child's shame? It's a feeling that exists in the child of shame, but it's not really the child's shame because the child didn't abuse itself. The adult abused the child. So it's really the adult's shame that the adult has refused to own and refused to take responsibility for and now blames or projects that emotion onto the child. And because the child, being a child, doesn't have the ability to easily determine what is right and wrong within itself, it then thinks that it must be wrong, that the child has been the problem. Does that make sense? But this shame does not really belong to the child, it belongs to the adult. Most people have huge difficulties feeling shame. And yet, if they realize that almost all shame that comes from your childhood is not your own, but rather somebody else has projected at you, you would probably allow the feeling of shame to come up more frequently and to be felt. Now, there is a shame that belongs to you, the adult, now that you're an adult, and that is the shame of anything you chose to do out of harmony with love. So whenever we choose to do something out of harmony with love, it affects our internal conscience. Is that how you spell it? Yeah. And therefore, there's a law of compensation in motion that's generated as a result of anything you choose to do out of harmony with love that causes shame to begin inside of you. So I'm not talking about that shame. I'm talking about the shame that occurred during abuse that occurred as a child. That shame, the abusive shame, came from the adult. In other words, it's the refusal of the adult to honour that it is doing a shameful thing. Right? So whenever an adult has beaten you or so been violent towards you or sexually abused you or verbally abused you, like with sarcasm and humiliation and all those things, from God's perspective, that is the adult's shame. Does that make sense? That shame really belongs to the adult, but most adults don't want to feel that shame. And so what they do is they blame the child for the shame they feel. So they actually tell the child, it's you that has been the problem. You have something to be ashamed of. You made me do it. And if quite often people who sexually abuse children say to the children, you made me do this. If you weren't this or if you weren't that or if you, you know, didn't do that or if you didn't dress provocatively here or you didn't have walk around with nothing clothes on when you were little there, I wouldn't have done it. You know, that's what they say. And many people who violently abuse their children say, you made me do it. You didn't obey me. You didn't do what you were told. You didn't whatever. And they always finish up putting the shame onto the child. But what we need to do understand if we are going to process emotionally, we need to understand that the childhood shame is not really our own. It's just a feeling that's now inside of us, but the cause of it is not our own. So it's not our own actions that created the shame, but rather the adult's actions that created the shame. The adult has something to be ashamed of, not the child. And the only time we, as an adult, have something to be ashamed of is when we choose, as an adult, to do something that's unloving to another person. Then we have cause to be ashamed. And in fact, that shame can help correct us if we're sensitive to the feeling of it. Does that make sense? So, Angela, you want to take it?
Yeah. Thank you for that. So, I don't know that what shame feels like. Like, is that the feelings of not feeling good enough, of like never getting it right, of not being lovable? Like, I feel those feelings. Are those part of shame?
Well, they're often a part of shame, and many of them are often not true. They are true because the adult told you that they're true. And you now have reinforced these beliefs to yourself. So you know the feeling, I am not lovable. That had to have come from somewhere. Right? And it had to have come from an adult telling you or demonstrating through their actions with you that you're not lovable. That's where it came from. So you not being lovable is really a measure of the adult's poor treatment of you. That's why you believe that you're not lovable. You still need to feel the emotion, but you would probably find it easier to feel the emotion if you understood that the emotion came from the adult and was taught to you, rather than believing that the emotion is your own, rather than believing that you personally are not lovable. So if we look at the statement, I am not lovable, it's not a truth from God's perspective, is it? So from God's perspective, every single person who is one of God's children, and that's every single person, is lovable from God's perspective. In other words, every single person from God's perspective God loves them whether they receive that love or not. Right? Now, the fact that we then believe we're unlovable had to have come from someone other than God. And usually it came from in our environment, of which our parents were a large part. But it could also come from our, you know, going to school and being told that we're not lovable and so forth. Could come from there. But when we're told we're not lovable, we eventually start telling ourselves the same message. And the problem with telling ourselves the same message is we don't feel the feeling and let go of the feeling. Do you follow me? Because we're telling ourselves a lie. Whenever you say to yourselves, I am not lovable, you're basically telling yourself a lie from God's perspective. Does that make sense? So it's one thing to feel that you are not lovable. It's quite another thing to reinforce that belief by telling yourself that you're not lovable over and over again. Now, many of you will feel you're not lovable, and until you feel that completely, you will believe that you're not lovable. But you need to understand from an intellectual perspective that actually, from God's perspective, everyone's lovable. So you need to understand that even the belief, I am not lovable, is actually a false belief. It's in you now, but it's a false belief. It's a feeling that has to come out, so the only way a feeling can come out is by feeling it, but it's still a false belief. And that's what you need to realize. Now, shame is the kind of feeling that where you feel so bad about yourself, and you believe that everything that was done to you is your fault. That makes sense? So this is the primary feeling about shame, that everything that was done to you was your fault in some way. And what I'm constantly reminding people is that no, things that are done to you that are unloving are not your fault. It doesn't matter what condition of your soul was, they're not your fault. Because if somebody does something unloving to you, that is their fault, their responsibility, their shame, if you like, not yours. If you believe it's yours, it's highly unlikely you'll let yourself feel it. because there'll be no point to feeling it because you believe that you are shameful. When you understand that actually this shame was projected at you by another and it was their belief of you, you can now focus on that feeling that that was their belief of you or about you rather than your belief about yourself. Does that make sense? Yeah. Now, we're getting very intellectual here already, but some of you, just me acknowledging that much of your feelings are not actually your real, like they're not yours, that they're not, you didn't cause them. The real cause of most of our feelings when we're a child, in particular this is our own families generally or adult acquaintances, their projections upon us. That's the real cause of the majority of our feelings as a child. Now, when we grow up and we become an adult, now we are self-responsible beings, so whatever we project onto others that is unloving, that is our shame. No, that's not there. So there are times when you, at the moment, you think as an adult where you feel like that person's a terrible person, you're judging the person. Well, that's your judgment. That's not theirs. That's your shame. That's your unloving behavior. And this is what we've got to learn to stop, is learn to stop our own loving behavior, but feel about all unloving behavior that's been perpetrated towards us. Let it all go, in other words. Does that help, Angela? Yeah?
Okay. Thank you.
If we go across to Selena.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Selena. I had an experience when I was a child of a sexual predator trying to pick me up, and I never told anyone. I kept it to myself. My mom remembered I had nightmares, but I never told anyone until I was a teenager.
Sorry, say that again to me.
A sexual predator?
A sexual predator.
Yeah, tried to pick me up. I didn't even know what that was at the time. I was, I think, maybe four or five.
So this is a real event?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Good day.
And I experienced a huge amount of shame, even though I never told anyone what had happened. And he didn't actually touch me, but the insinuation was there of what he wanted, mm-hmm. even though I really didn't know what it was. Yep. I felt a huge amount of shame, even though I didn't understand the experience, yep. So much so that I couldn't tell anyone at
yep.
all.
Yep.
So where would the shame come from in that?
Well, sexual predators are very interesting in their ability to feel children's emotions, in particular children's emotions. Mm-hmm. Any child who has been made open to the feeling that it's their fault, and anything is their fault.
When bad things happen to you, it's automatically your fault.
Yes, and okay. usually it's our parents that make mm-hmm. us open to such a feeling.
Yeah.
That any bad thing that happens to us is your fault. And the parents do this through reinforcement. Like, so when they're smacking us, they say, it's your fault I'm smacking you. You know? So they don't say it's their violent action. They say it's your fault. It's something you did that caused them to smack you. So a lot of children, by the time they're 5 years of age, already believe, to a large extent, that most of the unloving behavior perpetrated towards them is their fault. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. It's because they're bad somehow. Uh-huh. You know, that's the feeling. Now, sexual predators are very, very sensitive to that feeling in a child. Can you see why? Because a sexual predator gets to abuse the child, and the child would automatically feel that it must be their fault. And nobody has to say anything to them about it. The child will feel that it was their fault. So they feel sexually dirty and ashamed, and they feel as a result, this is as a result of any perpetration of sexual abuse, and they, in addition to that, feel that it's all their fault. Now, a sexual predator is very, very open to that feeling in the child. So whenever the child has this feeling in the child that whatever will happen to them that's negative has to be their fault, this is an attraction to sexual predators. And in fact, the sexual predators often have spirits with them who are sexual predators who mark out the children in advance. So they walk into the room and already the sexual predator knows the child because the spirits with the sexual predator are telling the adult predator who's in the flesh are telling him who is actually open to this concept or idea about themselves.
So I actually did exactly what he needed by not telling anyone. He knew I wouldn't.
Correct.
Yeah.
He knew you wouldn't. Mm-hmm. He knew you wouldn't.
So he couldn't get caught.
Yep.
I couldn't describe the car or anything.
Yep.
Yeah.
He knew you wouldn't be able to because you had already accepted that it was all your fault.
Wow.
Great. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And by the time most children are 3, 4, 5 years of age, they already have these strong beliefs that anything negative that happens to them is their fault. And so this makes them very open and very easy for an adult sexual predator or an adult abuser to abuse the child and get away with it. Yeah. Now, in some cases, it's just very fortunate that they didn't have the circumstances and therefore couldn't abuse us. Mm-hmm. But many times you can feel their intention. So a child usually can feel the sexual intention of an adult quite significantly. And then if the child thinks it's already their fault, they already believe that the sexual attention coming from the adult is their fault, mm-hmm. before the whole thing begins even.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the child has been prepared, really, by its environment to accept this feeling that it is all their fault. Yeah, and it's very sad when you think about it, isn't it? Because mm-hmm. the average adult parent wouldn't conceive that whenever they say to their child, it's your fault that I'm smacking you, and basic things like that, that they're actually preparing their child
yeah.
to accept the blame of adult perpetrators of abuse. The average parent wouldn't believe that, but that's actually what's happening psychologically.
So educating children to protect themselves still couldn't...
Doesn't help.
It still happens because...
Spot on.
They can spot that child that's not going to tell no matter what.
They can spot the child.
Yeah.
And not only can they spot the child, but the spirit's with them. So there's a certain emotional thing that happens inside the child, and there's a colour that starts appearing in the tummy region of the child that a sexual predator just can scan the room, and I'm talking about a spirit one now, can scan the room and see every child who has that particular colour in their bowel region of their body, and the second chakra region of their body. They can see exactly who those people are, and they'll target them straight away. They'll motivate the sexual predator to target those particular people. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And it will only be circumstances that prevent the abuse from occurring, because the reality is the child's emotions are already open to accepting the abuse. Yeah.
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 That's great. Thank you.
Yeah. And this is why a lot of people say, well, my parents didn't abuse me, but my brother-in-law, or you know, my father's brother or someone abused me, or my uncle or my grandfather did, or whatever. And this is because there is this preparation going on inside of the child emotionally from the environment that the child's growing up in, that's causing the child to accept the blame of very negative events that the child is involved in, rather than seeing that the child's not to blame.
So my question was going to be on shame, so this is really good. For a long time I've been waking, when I wake up, like I wake up in a state of fear.
Yep.
But that's been changing, where I'm feeling really hot and I'm associating that with shame. So I'm obviously also getting spirit influence in my sleep state around the injury of the shame.
Remember, there are two causes of your shame.
And I thought it would be all sexual, but I'm feeling like it's an all pervasive shame, just almost for the fact that I'm here.
I also feel that it has sexual connotations for yourself
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
But if you think about you as an adult now, so you're an adult, a woman in this case, and you're feeling shame, there can only be two causes of your shame. So what did I just say were the causes? One is that it's someone else's shame that they perpetrated upon you when you were a child, that's still within you now as an adult. So that's one, isn't it? So yeah. You could say someone else's or others' shame, right? And the second one is?
What I have done.
What you have done. So in other words, your personal actions.
Yeah.
So self can be the other cause of your shame. Now, the majority of people, generally blame all shame just on themselves. That's not accurate, because not all shame is your own. As can be seen, when you're a child in particular, other people did things to you. Whether those people were in spirit or on earth, it's immaterial. They still might have done things to you. And that causes you to feel shame of some kind. Now, a lot of events that happen to people in the spirit world are just as sexual in nature as events that happen on earth. And so sometimes it's sexual events that happen in the spirit world that cause this shame to build up. But there is this aspect of self that I must recommend the majority of you do not run away from. So there's the other stuff that we've just talked about, but there's this factor of self as well that we need to be very careful we do not run away from. In fact, we're going to be very tempted to run away from that and blame all of our shame once we hear the explanation I just gave, blame all of our shame on other people and something that occurred in our childhood. And not all of our shame is the result of other people or what occurred in our childhood. In fact, a lot of our shame comes from a law of compensation of what we have chosen to do as an adult. And in our sleep state, we choose to do many things that we would not normally choose to do in our awake state. And the reason why is that in our sleep state, we have no, what you would classify as socialized checks or restrictions on our boundaries of behavior. So in other words, what you could get away with on earth, right, you will definitely get away with in the spirit world, but what you can't get away with on earth, you might still be able to get away with in the spirit world.
So look at my rebelliousness.
Well, I would look at, firstly, your first feelings. You need to learn how to trust your first feelings. So your first feelings were waking up, feeling quite afraid, feeling quite ashamed, and feeling that it was sexual in nature. Does that make sense? And yes, to be blunt with you, there are things that you are doing in your sleep state that are sexual in nature that in your awake state you would be ashamed of. Does that make sense? And you don't want to come face to face with that particular issue. Now, the reason why you choose to do those some of those things are related to what others did to you when you were in your childhood. But there are choices you are making as an adult that cause you to wake up in your shame. Now, the average person who wakes up in shame or fear instantly chooses to get away from the shame and fear. And usually they do that by jumping out of bed, getting themselves busy, trying to make their day busy, having a cup of, drink, whether it's a cup of tea or hot drink generally, because hot drink will make you feel less fear. And usually take some kind of addictive drink or food. In other words, high carbohydrate breakfast along with a cup of coffee or a cup of tea. This is a very common action to get away with the feelings. In other words, to push the feelings back down again. Yeah? And there are many things that you are doing that I've personally observed in your sleep state. Right? So that are related to your own shame.
And so I've got no memory of being sexually abused in my childhood. Are you saying that actually something did happen?
No, I'm not saying that something did happen, but I'm saying that you were prepared for such
feeling. That makes sense.
Through other things that were projected at you as a child. Yeah. And there was a lot of this emotion projected at you that you are to blame. Mm. And this is why you have so much terror in you now, along with, as I've discussed with you at other times, the terror that comes from the multi-generational terror of having, grandparents that lived in war-torn areas.
And parents.
Yeah, and parents who lived in war-torn areas. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Which makes you open to such things. But now you are choosing to act out many of these things in your sleep state that you wouldn't be comfortable doing in your awake state, because if you did it in your awake state, a lot of people would know that you're doing it. Does that make sense? But in your sleep state, everybody's doing it, so it doesn't matter. Does that make sense? And the reality is, the majority of people, even in this auditorium, are doing many sexual things that they would be ashamed of if they knew, if they remembered them in their awake state while they're asleep. Because there are far less social checks on your behavior when you're asleep. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Scary thought for a lot of people. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe, Sai, you're going to bring up... Yep, so let's... Because Sai's had this personal experience. You don't have to go through it, mate, but maybe... myself and Sai had a discussion last night. Myself, Mary, Sai and Selena had a discussion last night about things that Sai is becoming aware of that he has been doing in his sleep state. Does that make sense? And there are sexual things in nature that he's now having to come to terms with. He's had feelings come up, firstly, and then there's been a slow awakening to some memory-based feelings about what's been happening. So maybe you'd like to explain.
Well, I guess my question was,
and
you pretty much described what I mean, when you become aware of things you're doing, the next night I didn't want to go to sleep.
Yes, you're afraid to even sleep.
Because I don't want to do that. I don't want to be that. I don't want any part of it. I want it to be gone. And, you know, intellectually I know that I need to feel the emotion that's driving the action in my sleep state. But I'm wondering if you could just go through that maybe in relationship to the sleep state and connect that a little bit better for us or me. Or
sure.
Because I
do you mind if I give some specific detail about your situation?
No, not at all.
Correct me if I'm wrong, so keep the mic there with you. Sai had these recollections that he had built sort of a place in the sleep state, in the hills in the sleep state, where he would take women and basically have sex with them. That's basically the memories that you've been having from your sleep state. So he would, and not all of them were his wife, Selena. So this is like the challenging thing for both of them in their relationship, the fact that is not all of them are his wife. There's other women coming. And Selena has feelings that she has been there too, like watching it all happen as well. So you can imagine the feelings that they're having to go through as a result. Now, these feelings, firstly, are driven by events that are way, way long ago. So in other words, they're driven by feelings that you have regarding yourself sexually and what you can get away with women, basically, in this case, right?
Yeah.
And so while you might have... And I say might, loosely, you might have a marriage that's involved with fidelity. The reality is, in your sleep state, that's not actually happening. So in other words, there are actions that are being taken in your sleep state that are not in harmony with love of your partner, and certainly not in harmony with love of yourself or any of those things. So the question then becomes, firstly, how do we access these events? So we wake up. So in the morning, we wake up.
AJ, can I just, I'm sorry, can I just, like, is there just a mess of spirits going on here right now?
Of course, because many of the spirits have been involved in these activities all of their life on Earth and then in the spirit world as well. And they don't understand how such events could actually occur. But once they pass into the spirit world, they have a memory of what happened. So if you don't have a memory of it now, what will happen, or you refuse to have a memory of it now, what will happen is you'll pass and you'll gain a memory of it soon after you pass. And you'll actually attract the events, of course, because your soul's still in the same condition, and you'll attract, therefore, all of the memories associated with all the things you did when you were asleep. So right from when you were a child, inside of your soul is a memory of everything you've done when you're asleep and awake. And at the moment, most of us are in complete denial of what happened when we're asleep. And the main reasons why we're in denial of it is because we want to be, because it's bad. That's how we feel, right? We feel we have something to be ashamed of, and so we don't want to remember it. But the reality is, too, that many people are more truthful in their sleep than they are in their awake state. See, in your awake state, you get to put on the facade, the mask that we wear is often present, right? And so the mask that everything's fine sexually, I've got everything under control, can be in my awake state, while at the same time every night I'm having sex with different people, right? So those two events can be happening the same time. And it's only our addiction to the facade that causes us to maintain what we believe is a social etiquette or norm when we're in our awake state. But when we're in our sleep state, because of the fact is that there's no restrictions on our behavior, and most of our emotions will dictate our behavior, and because of that, we generally will engage in activity that we wouldn't normally consider to engage in our awake state. And it's actually rare for a person in their sleep state to be in a better condition than their awake state. It's a pretty rare event, actually. Usually we're in a worse condition when we're in our sleep than in our awake state.
This whole process kind of, well, it was initiated a lot by some of Selena's work, but it also, I became aware that the left side of my spirit body was actually very dark and very decrepit and very, and so then I had a clue that.
So you had pictures that the left side of your body.
And actually my left eye was spirit body was blind.
Yeah.
And so then I knew that it was female, and I went, you know, I did some work with my mom, but then, and then this thing came out of my sleep state, and I knew, well, it's just massive abuse of women, and so, you know, I now have seen my spirit body in the hells, all gray, just, and that's a really startling awakening to, you know, because, you know, I thought I was okay. I thought I'd handled it and everything's good and I'm Psy and I'm a, you know, going to be a star someday.
And I'm a progressive angel.
And then this gray, I see this terrible gray spirit body that's actually my, I mean, that's the person I'm going to be when I pass. If I passed right now,
correct.
That's who I am, and that's where I'll live.
Correct.
And that was a real startling reality for me.
Yes.
And
yes.
Motivator.
Yes, later in the week I'm going to read you some excerpts from the Life Elysian where it talks about the difference between a person's awake and sleep state and what actually, what causes the degradation of our, you know, moral condition, which is really what we're talking about here, the degradation of our moral condition. So firstly, let's look at how our moral condition degrades, shall we? Because it's important to understand how that occurs. Now, if we understand, firstly, that our parents, so I'll draw our parents, mum and dad, whether they were with us or not, had a certain collective condition. In other words, there's certain things that they agreed were okay, and there's certain things that they also felt were not inside of themselves. In other words, they had belief systems and emotions about all sorts of matters. Every single matter you can consider, in fact, the majority of person on earth has a belief system about, right? And these belief systems can be broken into lots of different areas. Now, some of the areas are moral in their nature. In other words, they affect not only our sexual morality, but they affect our morality in the way we act with other people, whether we're even-handed in the way we handle other people, whether we're just in the way that we handle other people and ourselves. They affect our ethics, whether we would do things to others that we wouldn't like done to ourselves, and vice versa, whether we would want other people to do to us things that we wouldn't do to them. And that's our ethical behavior. We also have beliefs about our sexuality generally, often which are not in harmony with God, but in harmony with all sorts of earth-based concepts. So, for example, the average male on the planet has this belief that the average male needs to have lots of sexual partners because, you know, he's not built to have one kind of feeling, right? And there is a feeling along those lines. The average female believes that the receiving of projections sexually is a measure of their attractiveness. So in other words, the average female will receive sexual projections from men or other women even, as long as those projections don't get taken into action while they're on earth. They will receive the projection as long as that projection has some kind of approval coming with it. So in other words, as long as the woman feels good about herself as a result of the projection. So when a whole heap of people say you're really attractive and they're all projecting sexually at her, she's happy with that. So there is this openness, you could say, to the absorption. Of emotion, of all sorts of emotions. Then we also have other belief systems that we could... Now, here I'm talking mostly about the sexual-related belief systems and moral-related belief systems, because these are the belief systems that generally cause a lot of our shame, right? But there's all sorts of belief systems. There's religious belief systems that will dictate how we feel about ourselves sexually. If you think about the average belief systems in most religions, if you look at the Christian religious faith, you can see that, you know, women are not permitted to teach. They have to teach with a head covering. There's this sort of underlying implication because women are not spoken about much in the Bible, particularly in the Greek scriptures of the Bible. There's this underlying implication that women are the causes of most sexual shame. In the Old Testament of the Bible, there is a long list of what women have to do in order to deal with menstruation, in order to be holy or clean. So there's this implication that what's happening to their body normally is not holy or clean. And so there's a lot of personal shame, physical shame about those kind of things that are caused by religious belief systems. The same applies to the Muslim faith, where the women have to go through certain processes or coverings over their head. In fact, many feel they have to cover their entire body except for their eyes, which is actually about the projections or avoiding the projections of men with regard to sexual projection. So in other words, there's a belief in the Muslim faith, basically the implication is that a woman is responsible for the man's sexual behaviour. Right? So this causes many women, of course, to feel quite a lot of shame when a man starts acting in a certain way that they feel is unwelcome. And when there's this underlying belief, they then start believing that they are responsible for the sexual behaviour of the male, and therefore they start looking at themselves. What am I doing? I've got to cover up more, right? Or something like that. Then we also have political effects on these kind of belief systems. In other words, what is our general belief in the country we live in? So in some countries, men and women are said to be equal. And I say said to be because it's not always the case. Even here in the USA, I think there's still a discrepancy between the average woman's earnings and the average male earnings, so which would tend to indicate that there's still a discrepancy. But there are political belief systems here where women are allowed to vote, men are allowed to vote. Women have just as much right legally as a man. Whereas you go to other countries, so for example, if you're in Vietnam or you're in some African country or South American country or some of the other countries in Asia, you'll find that this doesn't exist, you know, this equality. And in fact, there is still quite a lot of feeling that the woman is owned by the man. And in fact, in countries around the world, there's this belief that women can actually be murdered by the family if the family desires to do so as a punishment of the woman, without there being any, you know, recourse legally against such a thing occurring. So these are a whole set of political beliefs now that have entered the framework, if you like, of the beliefs of mum and dad. Now, as soon as the child is conceived, most of those feelings are now projected to the newborn child or the newly conceived child. In other words, these feelings and belief systems and everything start flowing into the child. Now, once the child is born, the parents start acting out these belief systems toward the child. So they actually treat the child in the way that they have come to believe is the right way to live. Whether it's right or wrong from God's perspective is almost immaterial, right? It's just what they believe is the right way to live, which is the sum total of all of these different belief systems inside of them. So now this child is growing up with some quite strong belief systems already inside of the child. Now, what does it do? It starts absorbing them, not just through the process of being around the parents all the time, because you know that whenever you're around a group of people, you start absorbing many of their belief systems, don't you? When you're around a group of people. It's not only through that process, but it's also through the way in which the parents treat the child. So the child becomes treated in a certain way in harmony with the belief systems of the parents. So if the parents believe that it's right to smack a child, then the child will get smacked. And in fact, if the belief system of the parent is a religious belief system that if you spare smacking the child, you're spoiling the child, now there's actually a God-based religious belief system telling the parents to smack the child, which that child will grow up with and eventually also probably believe that it's acceptable from God's perspective. So they'll even start believing things about God that are completely out of harmony with love, but completely in harmony with all of these systems. Now, some of the beliefs about the child are what you would classify, or what the average person on earth would classify, as positive beliefs, but are just as negative as the so-called overtly negative beliefs. Now, if I can illustrate that. If both of these parents believe that the woman is more important than the man, now that is possible for both parents to believe that, isn't it? So the average male in this audience actually believes a woman is more important than a man. Like, because you, many of you men are actually projecting at the woman that I want to serve you, I'll do anything for you. You know, just as long as you have sex with me, I'll do anything for you. Basically, that's the feeling. And that feeling is basically telling the woman in the audience that they are better than you, that they have a higher position, if you like, in terms of your eyes, that they are more equal, if there's such a thing. You know, it's like the communist viewpoint of more equal. And so what they finish up believing is that, so if this man has a very pandering attitude towards a woman, and this woman has a feeling that she's the, as the saying goes, wears the pants in the household, this family will believe that the woman is the most important person in the room, in any room. If this is a girl child, what will she grow up believing? She will grow up believing the same, that she is more important than any other male. Now, while that means that she will have a fairly good, what would normally be classified on earth as a fairly good opinion of herself, I suggest to you that this opinion of herself is highly inflated, because it's not about equality, right? In other words, she believes things about herself that are completely out of harmony with God's viewpoint on the matter. But she and her parents will feel that that's good. Does that make sense? So there are times when the projections of the parent upon the child are such that the child grows up believing that certain things are good when they actually are not. Right? And then also the child can grow up believing certain things are bad when they actually are good. For example, if these parents believe that it's never good to actually tell a person the truth about themselves, then this child will feel that every time somebody tells her the truth about herself, they're being unloving to her. That's what she'll grow up believing. So she'll grow up believing that it's right for her to reject anybody who tells her the truth about herself. She'll believe that's an unloving act. Right? So can you see there are times when this child now will believe there's certain things that that the child believes is good, but from God's perspective would actually be out of harmony with love. And there's certain things that the child believes is bad, but from God's perspective it would be in harmony with love. Now that creates a fertile ground for a lot of actions that are out of harmony with love in both directions. Now when I say in both directions, I mean actions taken out of harmony with love because you think you should be able to get away with it, when from God's perspective it's out of harmony with love, and then actions that are taken that are in harmony with love that you believe that are out of harmony with love. So it leaves a fertile ground for that to occur as well. So you might tell the truth to somebody and then they get angry with you, and then you feel, oh, I'm terrible, it is my fault, I shouldn't have said that. No, you should have said it from God's perspective, but your belief is, from this childhood belief that I've mentioned, your belief might be that you shouldn't have said anything that might cause another person distress, even if it's true. Right. Now, once that occurs, and the reason why I've gone through that explanation, is that once that occurs, the child would choose throughout its life to do certain things. Some of the choices the child makes are in avoidance of love, and some of the choices the child makes are when it thinks it's loving to itself when it's really not. So, for example, if I'm a woman who's grown up in this environment where both the men and women think that it's great for the child to receive sexual projections, from men as a way of getting their approval sexually, then this woman, when she grows up to be an adult, she's going to believe that it's appropriate for her to get a sexual projection from everybody possible, and in particular men, if that's who she received it from. So if she received it from her father, and it was done in this attitude where he didn't abuse her, so-called, but he loved her, then she's going to grow up believing that every man has got to project sexually at her to make her feel attractive and lovely. And as soon as a man doesn't do that, she'll believe that he's not a very nice man. Does that make sense? Now, if he's a man, so if we now swap it over to be male in this case, and he's grown up in a family where the father has been dominant, and the mother agrees with the father's dominance, in other words, the mother supports the father's dominance, and this is just one scenario where it can occur, this young boy will then believe that from a sexual perspective, he's king. And he'll believe that he should be able to go around doing any sexual thing to any woman and get away with it. Now, society will try to pull him back into line to whatever is the social norm. But in his sleep state, there are no social norms to control his behaviour. So he will then do what is the social norm in his awake state, but in his sleep state, do something completely different. And if it's the girl that I mentioned, in her awake state, the social norm might be she's okay to receive sexual attention from all sorts of men as long as they don't harm her or be violent towards her. That's her awake state belief. In her sleep state, she's probably going to go further than that and believe that it's okay to have sex with these guys in order to get that kind of approval. Does that make sense? And this is why there is often a discrepancy between our awake and sleep state. The social norm will dictate our behaviour, but the emotional injuries will still be present. And those emotional injuries will be acted out whenever we are unrestricted, when we feel we're in an unrestricted environment. This is also why someone like a pedophile who has a certain set of climates that are created through these things, the pedophile, the child who's been harmed by the parents sexually in terms of belief systems, grows up to be a pedophile, and when he's a grown man now, he believes that certain things are acceptable and certain things aren't. And he will do what society dictates as normal when he's supposedly in company, but you put him in private and he will do what his emotional conditioning will do. Does that make sense? So this is why a lot of pedophiles that might seem normal in social situations, you know, there might be the church leader, even a minister, you know, like the local minister or someone like that in a social situation where he's looked up to and he seems like he's all pious and he seems like he's got everything under control sexually, but you put him alone and he's looking at pedophile pornography and trying to find members of his congregation that he can engage with sexually that are children. And it might take many, many years, if not decades, for him to be found out, because he will be able to target the children who have internal shame that have already been prepared through this other process that I previously described. Does that make sense? Now, the question then becomes, how do we address all of this? If we're in the position where we're now this child as an adult doing things that we think are all right but are obviously not, or we're waking up when we feel ashamed, which is a great indication that we're choosing to do things that are out of harmony with love, particularly if we wake up ashamed, that's an indication. If you walk around life ashamed, then it's usually an indication that you've taken on a lot of shame. But if you wake up ashamed, it usually means that you did things that even to your own mind in your awake state feel a bit off, right? Feel that you need to be ashamed of. Now, what we need to do is work out what we're going to do about all these things. Okay, so what do we do?
Well, before you can change anything, you must first face the truth. But before you can face the truth, you've got to know the truth about yourself. So, the very first thing we need to start to think of doing is to want to know the truth about ourselves, whether we're awake or we're asleep. It's immaterial. We want to get to a point where we have a desire to know the truth. Once we have a desire to know the truth, a true desire to know the truth, God, through a series of processes and through our emotional condition, can show us the truth. So, for example, when you wake up feeling ashamed, there is a truth being shown to you. That something happened in your sleep state that you're ashamed of. That's the truth. If you wake up feeling scared, that's the truth being shown to you. There's something in your sleep state that you're frightened of. Right? That happened in your sleep state. Now, if you pray about that particular thing, God, through a series of events and through a series of things that happen to you, including what happens in your dreams and what happens in your experiences when you're asleep, will be able to show you what's happening. But you've got to be open to it. Otherwise, you won't get shown. But you can get shown quite easily, which is what happened with yourself, Si, right? You wanted to know the truth, and as soon as you wanted to know the truth, yeah. And I remember when Selena first raised the issue in that discussion that we had, and remember I said to you last night how your face went really grey and you went out of your body while she was speaking. Like, and I'm watching, so Selena was sitting over here in our discussion and you were sitting over there, and Selena's asking me a question about her sleep state, and I'm watching Si. And I'm going, yeah, what she's bringing up now, it's got a big effect on him because he's tuning out, he's zoning out, his face went grey even, like, and he sort of went into that real zoned out spacey state that people go into, that I observe in many of you often. And you can see that, yeah, there's something that really troubles him here. Does that make sense? Now, to Si's credit, he wanted to know what was going on. And over the next day or so, he starts receiving dreams, which is actually you telling you in your awake state what's happening in your sleep state many times, or what the problem is emotionally. Right? So many of our dreams are you setting up an event where you tell yourself something that you become conscious of in your awake state. Selena, you want to just, if we grab the mic...
So if he hadn't been open to that, how would it have taken me a long time to get there on my own?
I had been working on it
for quite a while already.
If he hadn't have been open?
Yeah, if he simply wasn't going to go there?
Correct.
Because he was...
Well, you know the relationship in terms of your relationship, so, and if you don't mind me talking about it more clearly.
Not at all.
So here's Selena, and here's Si, S&S. Does that mean the double S or the SS? I better not call them SS there. Just get away with that. I'm not saying you're a good star or something like that. So here we have a male and a female in a relationship. If the male is doing things in his sleep state that he never wants to become aware of, and the female is involved in some way in those particular events, right? Then can you see that she has to be closed to also seeing the issue in her awake state? But as soon as one of them starts feeling there is an issue, and Selena, you started feeling there was an issue first,
for quite a while. Yeah. I was waking up afraid. I knew something.
So how long have you been feeling there's an issue?
Oh, 2 months.
2 or 3 months, okay. So, yeah.
And clenching my teeth at night for a long time.
So you're waking up afraid.
Oh, pain.
And in pain, waking up feeling quite afraid, waking up sometimes feeling ashamed. So waking up feeling a few emotions, so you know there's a problem then. Mm-hmm. So you were aware of the problem first, yep, and that's why you asked the question. But then when I started stating what could be happening, I didn't tell you both what was happening, I just said, this is you telling you that there's something going on. As soon as that started happening,
So I started having an opening to the possibility of something going on. Now, if he refused to open to the possibility of what was going on, you can still go through the process, couldn't you, to see what was going on?
But I really believed it was just me, all me.
Okay, then this. Yeah. But if you think about your emotional preconditioning, this is from, as I've discussed with you, from a child, this is something you have believed most of your life, that if something goes wrong, it's my fault. So does that make sense?
Yep.
Oh, and so this emotional preconditioning would have caused you probably to feel quite distressed for many years even before you might come face to face with the fact that there's a problem. What generally happens though for the majority of relationships is eventually the person who feels there's a problem right from the start or from a certain point in time, over a period of years, they become aware of their behaviour in their awake state. Right? And so therefore they do finish up seeing that there is a problem. Right? Of course, if you could be aware of the behaviour in the sleep state, you'd know straight away, right? which is what the process is you've gone through.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. But your emotional preconditioning caused you to then feel that it was your fault that you feel this way, rather than something that Sai might be doing that involved you.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yep.
Yeah, I was extremely grateful that he had that experience.
Exactly, because if he didn't...
It was a huge relief for me, yeah.
If he didn't, you might have continued to blame yourself for quite some time.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Waking up feeling a certain way, not understanding why.
Yeah.
And if he was unwilling to face the issue, it would have required you working through your emotional preconditioning first before you would have ever seen what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is where if both parties are brave... Mm-hmm. They'll be able to face the issues of what's really going on. Yep. And there is a lot more sexual infidelity in the spirit world than there is on earth. That's the reality. Okay, so if we come down the front here, then we go over here. So if you hold up nice and tight, that's good.
What's
your name?
Marty.
Marty.
I have had... Well, I came from a sexually abusive family, and
yep.
then I confronted them actually like starting 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And I would say every single night since then, and maybe even before then, but I'm like chased and they do everything to dismantle anything I can create. And I mean, it's pretty much the same way in real life for me without them being involved in the physical.
Yes.
Where I can never even get even like, if I can get enough ground to even stand on with one foot, I'm lucky.
Yes. So here's you, right? And the family that perpetrated the abuse, because it's always a family generally, because there's a certain preconditioning that's got to happen, and whatever the member of the family is, oftentimes it is the male, but sometimes it involves both, or is the female. Whatever it is, there's emotional preconditioning that established the abuse in the first place, right? And then so abuse occurred as a child. And then as we grow up to become an adult, a lot of abuse victims say, I don't want to be the victim anymore. What I'm going to do is stop these people from influencing my life. So what they do is they basically cut off their family from influencing their life anymore in a physical sense. The problem with that is that the person themselves doesn't deal with certain emotions generally. So they don't feel their shame. They just bottle it up and bury it. They don't feel their terror, because usually involved with any abuse, there is a lot of terror and fear. And so they bottle that up and bury it as well. And usually there's also, capping a lot of this stuff is an anger that develops inside of the person as well about what happened to them. Does that make sense? And they bottle that up and bury it too, generally. So now we're suppressing very large amounts of internal emotions that all need to come out. Now, many people in their awake state then choose to do things like changing their name. So they want to have a complete different persona than the child of what happened to the child. Does that make sense? So they change their name. They start taking medication for their depression, because usually they have depression by this stage. They have some form of depression where they feel bad about themselves and they try to deny that they feel bad about it. So they go into a depressive state. Oftentimes then medication is needed, or they might have their first child and that triggers memories of events that they suppress, And so what happens then is they have what's called postnatal depression, and then that sort of leads into other things, and then they start taking medication in order to suppress those particular things as well. So there's a lot going on for this person who was the victim of this abuse. Agreed? And any person who's been abused knows that it's a lot going on, right? So there's this abuse that occurs. Many times this person also becomes hypervigilant. In other words, they're always on the lookout for something going bad. And they also become quite what you would call like manic in their behaviour many times. In other words, they're very, very busy in their life. They become very busy. Often they become what are called super achievers, you know, where they're just busy, busy, busy. And the main reason why they achieve a lot is because they're busy all the time, because they don't want to stop, because as soon as they stop, they feel bad. So they're busy, their life, and so forth. So all of these emotions are still within the person, right? Not being released. So even though you have precluded this group of people who created the events from your life in a physical sense, because you can do that here physically, of course, you can't preclude them from your life in a spiritual sense without releasing these emotions. So from a spiritual sense, you're going to attract people in your awake state, you're going to attract people who are very, very similar to the abusive family that you grew up with. In other words, you'll attract men from the spirit world who had the same kind of attitudes towards you that your father had, or whoever the abuser was had. And you'll attract women from the spirit world that have very similar attitudes and beliefs about what your mum has. Does that make sense? Now, most people on earth walk around very unconscious of the spirit entourage that they're walking around with. But these spirits are constantly trying to influence their life in a negative way, generally in a negative way, or what they believe is positive for themselves. In other words, they're very selfish spirits and they're just trying to get their needs met through this individual. But when you go to sleep, there is no barrier that you can enforce. Does that make sense? And so that means that these very people who follow you around all day or every day that you can maintain a degree of autonomy from and maintain a degree of distance from, when you go to sleep, you can no longer maintain the distance. All of these things in you will attract these events and attract the kind of people who are willing to perpetrate these events in order for you to release the emotion. Does that make sense? There's a purpose to it, and that is that you finish up releasing these emotions. The majority of people, what they do, though, is they wake up terrified of all of these kind of emotions. Many people, therefore, don't sleep very well, or they sleep at odd times. You know, they sleep during the day when all the other people are at work, and they go to sleep. They wake up at night whenever all the other people are awake, so that anybody who's also asleep can no longer affect them. Right? Because remember, these attractions are still occurring at a soul level. So the only way to prevent these attractions from occurring is to actually work your way sincerely through these emotions. That's the only real way to prevent the attractions occurring in your sleep state. So what happens for most people is in their awake state, they have a semblance of normal life because they can prevent these kind of people to a degree from influencing them. And bear in mind that you can't prevent the spirits from influencing you still. And so the spirits generally surround you in that place. But when you go to sleep, you can no longer prevent their influence. And whatever emotions you have that you haven't dealt with will draw specific events to you involving generally the same kind of people.
So they seem to want me to not be able to exist, so that would be coming. So I'm not quite understanding. Like, I know when I know there's this sense that they don't want me to be able to survive on the earth, get any grounding. So
not exist is the feeling they want, yeah?
Yeah, I agree. To not be able to have any sustenance at all.
So not survive, yeah?
Yeah.
Now, you think about your parents' emotions towards you.
Mm-hmm.
What were their emotions towards you in that regard?
Probably, I was one of seven children, so we just the fact that we existed was very problematic.
Correct. Yeah, the feeling I feel from them is this feeling that, you know, they didn't really want that many children.
They didn't. It was like an Irish Catholic, seven kids,
correct.
One after
it
the other.
It was religiously forced upon them.
And then he had all the sexual abuse energy, and then she was the split-off wife who just sacrificed us up to it.
And became a martyr.
Yeah, and totally dissociative.
Yes.
Yeah, she didn't even have enough emotions to be a martyr. She just was like, I don't know what's going on, kind of thing.
Well, she knew what was going on, but she doesn't want to be
conscious
of it, right?
Yeah, that was her stance.
That's her stance. Her explanation is she doesn't know what's going on, but the reality is she knew what was going on and just didn't want to be
conscious. And what's interesting, she has taken on the lead of the pack of destroyers when I go to sleep. Now she's at the helm. She's become much more aggressive in the dream plane. Yeah. So she's getting them, if they find me doing anything, like if they find me, even if I find a broken down car, I can drive away and they're able to, she tells them and they find me.
Can I explain what often happens to a wife whose husband abuses his children? The wife often feels jealous of the husband's, of the child. Do you understand? And as a result of their jealousy, they often project at the child that it's the child's problem as well, that they enter a competition with their child. And from that point on, if it develops into rage, they become resentful of the child's existence, resentful of what the child does, resentful of any success the child might have, and so therefore becomes the leader of a group of people who attack the child. Does that make sense?
And one more thing, when I'm...
So can I just stop you for a sec? You're not feeling what I'm saying to you, right? And it's okay, you're allowed to not feel what I'm saying to you, but If what I was saying to you was hitting your heart, you would already be probably crying by now.
Well, that's my thing, is I'm afraid of getting blamed for what they're doing to me.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And in fact, you do believe you are to blame for what they're doing to you. Right? And this is what shuts down your grief about what they're doing. See? You believe that you were to blame for them feeling, that you were to blame for existing even. No. They had sex. That's how you came into their family, you know, and that attracted you as a soul into their family. But you believe it's your fault somehow because they felt it was your fault. And that's what's shutting you down emotionally. So if you allowed yourself to feel, right, that it's not your fault, and there's no need to do that, Jen. If you just allowed yourself to feel that it's not their fault, not your fault, but theirs, and allowed yourself to see that, you would connect to the grief more readily. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think when I look at them, when I know this thing's going on in my life, I'm afraid I'll be blamed for the fact that this attraction's there, kind of a thing.
Yeah, the reality is there are feelings in you that do allow the attraction, but you did not even put these feelings there. So you're not to blame for the feelings existing, but the feelings are in you and only you can release them. So it's a very different viewpoint. You're not to blame, but you need to take responsibility for the feelings to release them, otherwise they will stay with you. Does that make sense? So the key now is to allow yourself to feel your way through these things and some of these, so Motti, some of these statements that you make about yourself now are clues as to what's getting projected at you all the time. And the key for you is to allow yourself to feel your grief and fear about those things. And if you did that, you'll release those beliefs. And once those beliefs leave you, it'll be like creating a wall, a spiritual wall, against the attack. And after that time, nobody will attack. Does that make sense? So when I first started telling people that I was Jesus, it was nearly 10 years ago, right? In the first year, I used to get phone calls from people who said they were going to murder me. And I used to get a lot of them. Like, there was a couple of people in particular who concerned me enough to think about calling the police, you know, because of how strong their level of rage was. And to be honest with you, if I didn't deal with some emotions, I'm pretty sure they would have killed me during that time. That's how they were willing to. And they told me they were going to, and they had the plans all set in place. But what happened was I dealt with some emotions about being attacked, And after 1 year, I didn't receive a single call from them anymore. Not a single one. But instead, I started receiving a lot of emails about getting attacked. And once I dealt with some more emotions about it, all of those emails stopped. There was one time when I received about 180 emails in the space of a week of people who were going to murder me. Right? And I dealt with a lot of emotion about all of that. And then all of those emails stopped, and it doesn't seem... We had a lot of media attention after that, and I didn't get any emails at all from anybody who said they were going to murder me. There were people who just called me an idiot then. So then I had to feel about that. Does that make sense? So I had to work my way through specific emotions. Every time you work your way through a specific emotion, what happens is it's like a barrier, and it's a natural barrier of love that actually gets established. It's not based on fear or terror or control or any of those things. It's just a barrier that gets established where you no longer, for example, if you dealt with your terror, you would no longer feel worried about terror. You would no longer feel terror inside of you. You would no longer feel terrified about any event. And probably fear would also go when once that occurs. And now you'd have a barrier. And as a result of this barrier, you would no longer attract events that would make you feel terrified. Whether those events occurred in the sleep state or the awake state, doesn't matter. You just no longer attract them. So a lot of the times now, like people think, boy, you know, you must get a lot of attack. And no, I don't. I don't get a lot of attack now. But that's 10 years after dealing with, like the first 5 years, I just got attacked all the time, like all the time. And I had to work through lots of emotions before this barrier naturally established itself. And as a result, hardly get any now. Still get occasional ones for different reasons, but not like hundreds of them anymore. And not, I don't, you know, get people on the phone yelling and screaming at me and telling me they're going to cut and slit my throat and rape Mary and all those kind of things anymore, right? So, you know, the attack has reduced because you deal with some of the emotions. So the secret to this is deal with the emotions you feel and actually feel them. Allow yourself to feel them. But realize you're not to blame for them. And this is what's shutting you down, is that there's a feeling in you that you are to blame for them. That shuts you from feeling them. And when you blame yourself for things that happened in your childhood, you are really falling into the trap of reinforcing your parents' beliefs all over again with yourself. You're basically telling yourself what they told you, thinking that it will protect you. Now, that worked when you were little, right? And the only reason why it worked was because you became in agreement with your parent, and therefore parents who feel the agreement generally feel that that means that the child doesn't need to be corrected in some way. Make sense? But as an adult, you are allowed to have a different opinion. And the only way you're going to maintain a different opinion is by working your way through the emotions that have been created. And the only reason why you'll do that is when you stop believing that they are all your fault. That's the only way you'll stop doing that. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. If we come across to here. Where's the other mic? Yep. Sorry. Just down there. Thanks.
Hi. You've spoken a lot about the feminine and masculine injuries as they show up in our body. Mm-hmm. And I have a lot of injuries on the left side of my body. Mm-hmm. And so much so that I'm severely contracted on the left side. And I know that that's about feminine, how I see myself as a woman primarily, mm-hmm. which is influenced not only, like that doesn't necessarily mean it's a relationship issues with my mother, it could also be how my father viewed me and my mother as women.
Certainly, there's a combination of factors, isn't there? If we look at our two parents, so we've got our father, he has beliefs about women, and he has beliefs about men in comparison to women. And if you look at your mother, she has beliefs about women and beliefs about men in comparison to women. Your father has beliefs about men and therefore about himself and beliefs of women in comparison to men, and your mother has the same cycle. So basically, there's these four groups of emotions that are getting projected at the child regarding their gender. So here's the child. So they're receiving these groups of belief systems coming from both parents, not just from one. And by the way, this applies even when one of the parents was not living with you. Right? There's still the projection emotionally from the person who was involved in your creation. When I say creation, the creation of your two bodies, not you. And so these two people have a large bearing on what you're going to grow up believing about yourself. Now, in addition to that, you're going to have, as a result of those injuries, you're going to have a projection at men about what you expect, and a projection towards women about what you expect from them. So in other words, you will develop expectations and demands upon both genders. Now, most of our physical issues revolve around expectations and demands that we're making upon others, actually. And in other words, they revolve around unloving behavior that we automatically engage without thinking. And we do it without thinking because we've been predisposed to it by growing up in a certain environment. So the question I would start asking myself is, okay, what are my expectations of women? So what are your expectations of women?
Well,
hold the microphone up.
Right. I'm kind of scared of them.
You're frightened of them?
Yeah.
What was your mum like?
Well, she's not very free, and she seems quite bound by expectations, and
so why are you afraid of them?
Because I've tried to please them. I've been.
So why did you try to please your mother?
I just seem to be programmed to do that. I think I had that feeling of shame or blame that I wasn't good enough. So I tried to be.
What was your name again?
Catherine.
Catherine, that's right. Catherine, there's a lot you're not saying about your mother.
Yes.
You're not being honest about her.
Okay.
You don't even want to say what her personality and nature was in terms of her treatment of you.
Yes, because I'm afraid of her.
Yep. And you don't even want to say how she treated you. You don't even want to be honest about it.
Yeah.
Now, if a person doesn't want to be honest, remember?
Yeah, okay.
You're never going to face the truth. If you don't want to be honest about what actually happened with your mum, then you're never going to face the truth about it. So what you're doing instead is you're shutting down the left-hand side of your body, right?
I'll be honest then. I mean, I obviously should know that I want to be, but I am scared. That's why I'm not. But
just stop. That's not a good enough reason.
No, no.
And every time you say, "But I'm scared," that's why I'm not.
Yeah, I know.
You are basically saying that is a good enough reason. You know, you're basically giving yourself a way out of dealing with the emotions.
And I've done that. I've lived in fear.
But there is a justification of fear going on.
Yeah.
You're basically saying, but I'm afraid. I should be able to get away with it.
Yeah.
But I'm afraid. How can you expect me to deal with that? Yeah. But I'm afraid. And I'm saying to you, but you're afraid is not a good excuse. In fact, it's a very self-defeating excuse. Every time you say, I'm not going to do it because I'm afraid, you are defeating yourself. No one else is involved in your defeat. You're doing it to yourself. Right? The key is to face the truth about what you're afraid of, feel what you're afraid of.
So I haven't been treated well by my mother or my grandmother or my older sister or my female bosses, my female colleagues.
These are law of attraction events.
Yeah.
Showing you that there is a large amount of fear inside of you about women.
Yes.
I agree.
Yes.
So your first step is to be honest about it.
Yeah.
You follow? That's number one. You need to be honest. Because you've got to know the truth before you can face it. Before you feel anything about it, you have to know it. So you've got to be honest about what's actually happened. So what's happened with your mum? What's happened with your sister? I would get out a thing and note everything down of all the things that you feel where you weren't treated lovingly or fairly by these people. Same goes with your female bosses. Same goes with every female in your life. How have they treated you? What's been your... You know, and there's a feeling inside of you too that, oh, men are easier to get along with as well as a result. And that is also a flaw because men aren't easier to get along with at all, right? There's just a belief in you that they are as a result of what's happened through these events. Does that make sense? And so you now have a whole heap of expectations about women as well. So you expect women to treat you better than they do. Right, so you're a bit angry with how women treat you generally, and you withdraw from their company generally. And in fact, you're more sensitive to them being honest and truthful even with you than you would be with a man. So if Mary was up here telling you some truth, you'd be a lot more resistive to hearing it than you are from me, just because of these predispositions of feelings that you have about women. Does that make sense? Now, you need to understand that if something's physically happening to your body, then it means this problem is long-standing and well-entrenched. You see, by the time it affects your body, there's already a lot going on, a lot of denial going on by the time it gets to affect your physical body. So the fact that something's affecting your physical body about it is an indication this is a long-standing and entrenched belief system that you believe you do not wish to fix, right? And the main excuse you give for yourself not fixing it is?
I'm afraid,
fear. And there's one other main excuse you have too. Do you know what that is?
It's my fault.
Well, that's certainly one of your belief systems, but there's an excuse that excuses you from feeling even that. So what if I give you some homework and you find the other one?
Sure.
You find the other belief. So fear is one of your beliefs. You understand what I mean by a belief? You believe that because you are afraid of women, you shouldn't have to deal with these issues.
Yes.
So what's another belief you have with regard to women that causes you to not have to deal with these issues is the question I'm asking. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, so if you have a think about what that might be, you have a number of them, but there's two primary ones. One of them is your fear. Far away.
And also, I'm wondering about spirit influence here, because I've been afraid all my life since I can't remember a time when I wasn't afraid.
Yep.
And yet I don't believe I've ever been sexually or physically abused. But I think that I was very sensitive to spirits and very afraid.
Well, every child is sensitive to spirits. But if you think about what I just said to you, how does that not apply to spirits?
Yeah.
It's exactly the same. What I just drew on the board was your wishing to close down on the female side. You're afraid of all the women. Now, what do you think your fear of women is going to attract?
Women angry.
Women who are... Like that, women to be afraid of, right? Yeah. Scary women, right? That's what that's going to attract. And that's going to attract them whether they're living here on earth or in the spirit world. Makes no difference where they live. The only difference is you don't see them. So if you can assume that if you've had a long list of women treating you badly on earth, then that would make sense, wouldn't it? That you must also, given the fact that you've got no protection towards this happening, are lots of women in the spirit world who also treat you badly. Surely that must be the case. So assume it's the case. Whatever is happening here on earth, if it's happening, and you have a level of control over it and yet it's still happening, has definitely got to be happening in the spirit world where you've got no level of control over it. Doesn't it? Can you see that? It's got to be happening. So let's say the average guy here has one negative experience with a male every year, and the rest of the time he spends most of his time with women, right? if he's got to assume that if he's got one negative thing going on with a male a year, that there's got to be more than that happening in the spirit world, where he's got no level of control or protection over it. Any event that's happening here on Earth in a fairly regular or semi-regular basis has to be occurring in the spirit world, where you have less protection against it occurring. So what I find quite remarkable for most people is that they ask me the question about what's happening on Earth, and then they say, well, what's happening in the spirit world then? And I feel like whatever is happening on Earth, multiplied by 3 or 4. That's what's happening there. Does that make sense? Generally, that's what's going on there. Yeah. Mary?
When you say protection in that context, you mean control, don't you? You mean us actually controlling our lives to prevent things rather than... Because God's laws, if we're in harmony with God's laws, they're protecting us whether we're here or there, hey?
Correct. So if this is us and we are in harmony with all of God's laws of love, so we're in a perfect state of love, let's say we're at one with God, there's this sort of protective barrier around us created by our soul. So it is a protective barrier that's created by soul, but you could almost consider it as it's a love barrier, which means that only loving things can enter our soul. Does that make sense? So it's not really like an armor. It's just like a barrier of love, which basically says to the rest of the universe, only a loving event can happen to me. And only loving events do. But when we've got feelings that are out of harmony with love, and anger, shame, and other feelings, they create holes in this barrier of love, if you like. So now there's gaps in our barrier of love where when somebody projects certain things at us, it can enter one of these places that is open. All right? And all of that emotion can enter you then and damage you in some way, both spiritually but also energetically and physically it can damage you. So this is how spirits finish up getting attached to people as well. So this one here that I've drawn here is about the person's, let's say it's related to their second chakra area, which is about their self-worth. Now I have spirits, male or female, depending on the type of problem, who energetically project and attach to the person through that area so that they can make that person feel worse about themselves. And why would they do that? What do you get out of making someone else feel bad about themselves? You get to feel better about yourself. Yeah, that's right. So they get to feel I'm better than I really am by projecting all this crap out of somebody who accepts this other false belief that they're worse. Does that make sense? Now, once they close up that hole by feeling some emotion, that hole gets closed up. So now this hole's closed, right? What can happen now? There's a love barrier there, right? These people have to be the same amount of love as that barrier in order to go through it. Do you follow me? So they have to be, they'd be loving people, and what would they be telling that part of you? They'd be telling you, you're a nice person, you're a good person, you're worthy, you know, and even though you've got problems, you know, God still loves you, and God still, that's the kind of messages you'd be then getting. Can you see? But if that love barrier is not there, then any spirit who has any belief system about you can just project at you and you'll accept it. And it doesn't matter whether these people are on Earth or in the spirit world. They'll do it. You know, you walk up to the shopping counter and, you know, order some gear and they'll feel, yeah, I can dump on this girl. Right? I can dump on this lady. So they do. Somebody else walks up and they treat them really nice. Right? Because they don't have the ethics to treat all people well. They only treat people well who feed their addictions. Right? And they treat badly other people to meet their addictions. And once we're in a state of love, once we're in a state of love here, a person can have lots and lots of holes in their love barrier, if we can call it that, and we will not choose to damage them through those holes. If we were in a state of love, we would never choose to damage that lady, even though we know she feels bad about herself. Does that make sense? So we'd never choose to harm her. But people who are not in a state of love will choose to harm you if they can get away with it. They will. And the only way to address that is by clearing up the emotion that creates that hole. So that's an emotion that creates the hole. It's not an intellectual thought, it's an emotion. Once you clear up the emotion that creates the hole, nothing can enter that location anymore, except if it's higher than that inner condition of love. Then it can enter. So you get to the point, once you've cleared up that hole, that you only want to spend time and you naturally attract people who always think you're a nice person. Isn't that wonderful? Instead of naturally attracting people always dumping on you or feeling you're a bad person. Just by clearing up that one hole. And it doesn't matter whether you're in the spirit world, in the sleep state, or here on earth, you will attract the same kind of person. So it's immaterial where they are. You'll attract the same kind of person. Does that make sense? So if you understand that, then you can see the importance of knowing the truth, facing truth, and then the third thing, which is really, really important, and probably one of the most important parts of the process, and that is to feel the truth. Right? Many of us willingly do the first two, but when we get to the third, we're all resistive. We don't want to feel it. So, you know, we go, oh yeah, my mum, when I was five, you know, I just went up to her and said something, she just belted me across the face because she was just angry. And we talk about that with someone else, and it wasn't that terrible. Yeah, that was terrible, you know, that's what parents normally do though. So we're now knowing the truth, but not yet facing it. Then we go, when we start to face it, we go, wow, that was really quite bad actually, it was really off. And she did it for her own selfishness, like there was nothing, I didn't do anything wrong. And we start facing that, yeah, that was the truth, that she did the thing wrong, not us. But what comes next? Feeling about it. Now, most of the time, we don't want to feel about it. We'll talk about it. And do you know what I've found? The more you're talking about something, the less you want to feel about it. So if you find yourself talking over and over to different people about the same subject, that's the subject that you don't want to feel about the most. Generally, right? It's when you stop talking about it, and in fact, the reality is you will stop talking about it when you start feeling about it, probably. Because once you start feeling about it, talking about it feels cheap. Does that make sense? When you start feeling about it, the feelings are so powerful that you can't describe them anymore. So talking about it feels cheap then. Yep. Now, what I find with regard to abusive situations, is a lot of people who have been abused know they've been abused. A lot of them have faced the truth that they were abused. In other words, they have faced the abusive treatment. They know that it happened. And oftentimes, they have tried to prevent those people from abusing them anymore by withdrawing from their life and so forth. So they're facing the truth about it. But they still haven't yet felt the truth. They haven't felt how angry they are about it. They haven't felt how sad they are about it. They haven't felt how ashamed they felt about it, how afraid they were. They haven't felt those feelings. And because that is a requirement to patch up the hole doesn't get patched up. And when the hole doesn't get patched up, there's a gaping hole in that location, and that then allows more people to do what was done to you. And this is where we need to be willing to feel. Remember the definition of humility. Be willing to feel every single thing. Be willing to see yourself as God sees you. And if you can feel every single thing, then you start feeling the truth of what happened. When you feel the truth of what happened, you release the emotion that you've been carrying around. And when you release the emotion being carrying around, the hole gets all patched up. And now any person who wants to harm you in that place can no longer harm you. And it doesn't matter whether they're a spirit or a person on earth, they can't harm you anymore in that location that you've patched up.